2006 City Council meeting. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton? Councilmember Kendall? Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yeah.
Could we all please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please?
While we're doing this, I would just like to point out to everybody that we should be praying for the country. We should be praying for the recent tragedies, be it in Louisiana, Minnesota, Dallas, and today, Michigan. And that should be on all of our minds foremost. Thank you.
Flag salute. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coast and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. We'll move to city manager's report on issues raised at prior council meetings.
Nothing at this time.
We'll move on to special event applications. Leisha?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. First application is from the Asbury Park Film Initiative, and they're seeking to do their annual free movies on the beach. I would ask that this would be approved contingent on a list of the movies being provided and approved by provided by the applicant and approved by the Special Events Committee. Next is Surfing for Vision. This applicant is seeking to do a surfing clinic for individuals with low or limited vision. And this would happen on August 21st on the surfing beach. The Asbury Park Historical Society would like to return for their annual event on the boardwalk on August 21st. The Asbury Park Sunset Mind Travel Silent Piano Concert would also like to happen on the 21st after the beach closes. And what they would do is there would be an individual playing a keyboard, but there would be no amplified sound. Individuals would rent wireless headphones, and they would be able to hear the individual playing the keyboard. And the next application won't be discussed tonight. And that's the Asbury Park State of Education address. That won't be considered this evening. Next is the Run for the Arts 5K Run. This is a returning event which begins in Ocean Grove. They run over Heck Street Bridge, down Lake Avenue, on the boardwalk, through the casino, and back to Ocean Grove. The Asbury Park Yoga Festival would like to return for its event on September 18th. And lastly, we have a new event, March of Dimes Bark for Babies, which is a dog walk that would be held on October 8th. Any questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Leisha.
Thank you.
We'll now move on to items to be presented. The first one is by Madison Asbury Retail regarding the Fifth Avenue Pavilion band shell renovation.
Hello.
So that's not even bothered.
Yeah, Amy, they're up there. Can you see them? I tried to make them so that both the council and the public.
And I have pictures in my packet.
Too. Okay. Good evening, Carrie Turner, on behalf of Madison Asbury Retail. I wanted to kick it off to just give a little history of the project and also let the council and the public know what our subsequent development agreement says about specifically about this project. So if you'll permit me, it was last year on January 15th that the city actually issued Madison a notice of default on the design of the band shell. We submitted our first TRC application to the city on February 18th of 2015. That submission effectively cured the default. A meeting was held then on March 4th of 2015. We had a second TRC application submitted to the city on September 16th of 2015, and there was a meeting held on September 30th of the same year. The TRC at that time directed us to meet with the subcommittee of the TRC to work out the design differences that arose at that meeting. Those meetings were ongoing with a goal of coming back to TRC in Q2 of this year. The third TRC meeting was, application was submitted to the city May 17th of this year, and a meeting was held on May 30th. At that time, TRC did recommend that this move to this body for consideration. My understanding is that after the presentation tonight, a vote will not be held until next council meeting, not this week. And then given the above, just in terms of timing, that would make the earliest regularly scheduled planning board meeting that we could appear at be September 19th. So that's just sort of the trajectory of where we've been and where we hope we're heading, assuming we get a favorable response.
Why, there's no planning board meetings in August?
There's one, and it's on August 1st, John. So if you vote on the 27th of July, there's no way statutorily we can make the August 1st meeting date. So the next one after August 1st, the next regularly scheduled one is September 19th.
Well, so you can ask the planning board to have a special one.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Again, assuming that we're able to move forward. And then, again, if I may, I would like to read into the record what the subsequent developer's agreement says about this project, because I think it provides a little context. What it says is, the Banshell project, on or before December 31st of 2010, Madison shall design or cause to be designed the Banshell project. Such design work shall incorporate the existing concept of the Banshell structure and performance area and fixed seating for approximately 200 persons. The remainder of the surface area may consist of multiple purpose flexible space to allow for hospitality and entertainment uses, and may incorporate permanent or removable elements to maximize the use of this entire space in all seasons. And then it goes on to say, such design work will yield a conceptual design suitable for evaluation by the city, Madison, the TRC, the planning board, and the DEP, and include preliminary structural and construction drawings to demonstrate the technical feasibility of the Banshell project and allow for estimation of a construction schedule and the costs associated with the completion of the project. So there's a little bit more about, if it costs this much, we do that. If you'd like to, you want to know that part as well. If the estimated construction costs are $600,000 or below, Madison shall complete the project within 18 months of final planning board approvals. If the estimated construction costs are greater than $600,000, Madison shall complete the Banshell project within 30 months of planning board approvals. And so that is what our agreement between the parties says. I'm going to turn it over to our engineer and architect to walk you through the design elements of what we're proposing, unless you guys have any questions of me on the timing and or the agreement at this time.
Okay. As much as the agreement says 30 months, is that the schedule you're looking for?
I don't believe so, John. I mean,
No. Okay.
That would take us out of commission for way too long. So that's absolutely not what we would hope to do at all. So with that, gentlemen, if you let me introduce Phil Moss, our structural engineer, and Bill Miller, our architect of record. I'm a babysitter.
Do we have to be in front of this, or can we be in front of the boards?
Well, if you're in front of the boards, just talk loud.
Okay. I'm an engineer. I talk better with paper. We've been looking at this thing for a couple of years, and we initially started out investigating whether or not we can actually use it in its original configuration. And the problem with that is that the original slope of that, which had all the benches before, doesn't meet today's building codes. You can't comply with the barrier-free code, you can't comply with the ADA. In order to comply with that, you essentially have to terrace the structure, which then pretty much destroys its effect as a seating area. You'd have switchback ramps back and forth in order to provide ADA access. So then we were asked to look at what it would take to make usable with a series of flat platforms. And we looked at a number of platforms, some of the same issues came up. And then we were asked to look at a single platform with seating in the front, which was probably the first iteration you saw that we had worked on. That platform came from here to here, and we had step seating down there. We looked at that, looked at the cost associated with that, and asked to take it a little bit further so that we could turn this area into a venue for weddings and and such. At which point the thing had a pergola on top, which I think you saw that version as well. It then asked to take it yet another step further. If, what do we have to do to turn it into a 12-month bed? So we took the same essential concept and closed it with glass, put a real roof on it rather than a pergola, and this is what has been is in front of you right now. Essentially, dining area for this bay, seating area down here, the band shell is recreated, same geometry as it was, but with modern materials that will hold up. But otherwise, it'll be the same raised stage. 200 seats in this area right here. An enclosed dining area, operable glass on three sides, so the thing can be open on all three sides during the summer. These slide back this way and hide here. These slide back here and these fold down. Right now, these spaces are just placeholders until a tenant is in place so we can determine what we need in terms of kitchen space, bar space, how many bars and whatnot. This is what the elevation looks like. There's the band shell. It's hard to see from here, but the dotted lines are the original band shell, basically putting it back in the same place. We're going to raise parapets to hide mechanical units. We're going to have a raised screen here to hide mechanical units. That's a placeholder as well, as soon as we know how big the kitchen is, we'll know how big to make that, but you won't see anything from the street. The overall elevation is just about the same as the top of this. This is at 35 feet above the boardwalk, about 34 feet. We have a screen wall that comes across here. Behind that is a handrail. These are the sliding glass windows. And then the whole building will get a masonry veneer to cover that drive and make the whole thing uniform. At the ground floor level, we'll either refurbish and replace storefront with the option of some folding storefront, depending on what tenants end up in this space. Same elevation, just from the other side. Virtually identical, a little bit of difference in which rooms.
Phil, can I interrupt you
for
one second? Because this is actually also A5 is the drawing where we substituted in these other drawings because we are suggesting a change to the screen wall and what's on there.
Yes, that screen wall now is projected to come down at an angle like this, be less than barriers. So that's reflected in the wall piece.
Correct.
And you see the screen wall itself, and what you can see, it's not as solid as that front line drawing appears. It's much more open, much more visible. You can see the you view of what the seating of the band shell, this is oriented with the band shell, so you can see both replacing the original band shell. Essentially the seating is compressed with a shorter area than everything else. The fill function is zero.
Is that wood? What is that?
The seating, will be wood, yes. There'll be a steel subframe underneath it, and that'll be a wood set of benches, each about 3.5 feet wide. That'll provide like stadium type seating, bench seating. We'll have over 200 seats there. About the
calculation
exactly this change. We had 206.
At least 1,000.
Whoa. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's my question too. What was it previously? What was the capacity previously?
The original bench room? I honestly don't know.
Well over 1,000.
Well over. That's what I thought.
Okay, actually, before you go to material, so just so I have an idea.
Yes.
That's the seating here. These are placeholders over here for eventual tenants.
Yeah. I'll go back to this plan.
No, that's all part of the restaurant.
This is the top floor tenant.
Okay.
But what we don't know without a tenant exactly how big their kitchen wants to be.
Okay.
Or how many bars they want to have. So these little spaces in here are what we call placeholders to indicate we need something in there, but we don't know what.
Okay.
But I don't want you to think that this is the final geometry because we don't know that.
Okay.
You'll have access to these two sides. We have stairs here and here. handicapped access for the elevator on this side. Down here, we're gonna add an elevator to provide handicap access for the bottom side. So you'll have circulation area through here, and then somewhere in here, depending what the tenant wants. I mean, he may want a bar over here or in the middle instead of left. But we know we're going to need something about that size, and that's what we just picked to.
Okay, I got confused, got it.
Oh, I forgot, we're gonna add these skywalks back in. Big part of that. This will connect to McLoone's, it'll come out here, will stop at this location. Essentially function as a balcony on this side. We're gonna add it on this side, we'll reconnect to the ramp in front of McLoone's, we'll add a set of stairs on this side. So this will essentially be an elevated sidewalk along the side of the street as well. And that's your turn.
Okay, so picking up on that, where we're adding back, this is a restoration of the existing building. And if I can kind of show you here. So the existing structure is the McLoone's that you're familiar with, the stair tower, and then the diagonal shape of the roof, and then down to the flat area of the band shell, and then the end, southern end of the building. Everything below that diagonal edge, we are basically refurbishing. We're recladding the building, covering up that drive material. We are refurbishing and putting in some new storefronts, and then new handrails and new skywalks. So that'll pretty much restore the building to its original kind of form. The new addition that we're adding is above the diagonal. And the idea is where we have masonry below the diagonal, delineating the existing conditions, the new will be kind of a softer wood and where it's necessary, steel forms. So there'll be two different types of material, and the diagonal will be displayed. The third portion of that is the southern end, the band shell, which we are refurbishing, putting it back to its original form, but we're gonna have to use more modern materials to make it last longer. So if I can go to the elevations. This kind of gives you a good idea of where that diagonal is. Above it is the wood screen and the steel and glass enclosure. And then on the existing, we have masonry restoration and refurbished storefronts.
When you're all done, I have some questions. Mm-hmm.
That's it?
Anybody want to go first? Or?
You can go first. I have some questions too. You may have the same ones.
Yeah, we might all have the same. The capacity of the band shell. Okay, there's 212 seats, but you have the dance floor and you have the standing room only above the top railing. So what would the capacity of this outdoor area be, person-wise? And that leads into the question, are your little bathrooms enough for that capacity?
Well, we've done a couple of bathroom calculations and all that.
The answer is yes, we'll have plenty of bathrooms. Okay, we haven't designed the bathrooms into the restaurant area yet.
Right now I'm on the outside.
Understood.
Because the capacity, it's like conventional wall had a capacity of blah, blah, blah. But when you add it in standing room only, now if you're going to have people on the dance floor, so forget the 212 seats, you got the dance floor, which is quite big, and you got the standing room behind the railing before the glass windows.
So the answer is yes, we'll have plenty of.
Well, can you give us a number in 2 weeks what that capacity is going to be? I mean, I think it's very easy to figure out.
As yeah, I have. I, it's
so
I
many
have back in my office.
Okay.
Yeah, this space up here is designated for the
Right, but that's both men's and ladies' room for, and it doesn't look that big for, it may be a 1,200-person capacity, so.
It's plenty.
Okay, fine.
It's bigger than it looks because it's a small plant, but each of these bays is about 30 feet wide.
Okay, it says concrete pavers at bandshell floor.
Yes.
Now, okay, so then I have no problem with that. What will the floor be made of?
Of the dance floor or?
Yeah, the dance floor.
Well, the dance floor will be, there will be roof, right now it's concrete. There'll be a roofing insulation and a membrane, and on top of that will be concrete pavers to protect the roofing and give you a solid surface.
Okay.
It's concrete rather than a wood or anything because of the, it needs to be heavy enough not to blow away in a storm.
And because you don't have a tenant for the second floor, now I'm going inside the building.
Right.
So again, we don't know the capacity of that. We don't know if your restrooms are large. The outside bandshell area, I didn't see anything on here. Where's the roof drainage?
Under those concrete pavers.
To where?
Straight down and then out to the south.
To the street or to a?
Out to a lateral that runs to the south of the building.
Okay, so underground.
You will have drains in through here.
Uh-huh.
On this, let me go to the roof drain for this. Because you have a couple of different areas. This is actually the drainage here. We have drains by the columns. There'll be other drains in front of this area. Another set of drains in here, which you don't see because they're being hidden by the pavers. All of these go down, they come out here, and they come out here and go to the street that way.
Go to the street or go right into the...
No, not to the line in within the street.
Okay.
Next to the street. Okay. Nothing dumps on the street. Everything goes to the storm line.
On one of the pictures, and it's too big to open up here, it says new blade signs. What are blade signs on both sides of the building?
Those are the ones that extend out, John, that hang on the arms that are like my arm.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
They're the ones that
yeah.
are already down.
Yeah, just call those blade signs.
Okay. Are the new heights... But the stage, which are probably the same old heights, are they within the
state
beachfront guidelines?
Yeah, within the
path, yeah. Okay.
Nothing extends over.
This stage, right?
Height this
oh,
one.
The height of the
right.
Be what we're recreating.
We're not going to need a variance or anything because
we're
going to
put it back on
the okay. The stage is only 14 inches above the dance floor.
Right.
You think that's high enough? I mean, that's like, you got the stage is high, and like, so you might as well not even have a stage. Or
it's dictated by a ramp in order to meet ADA requirements for a handicapped performer. You have to have a landing at the top of the ramp. You have a certain amount of run that dictates how high that stage can be without seriously reducing the size of the stage. So that's where that distance came from. And that 14 inches is above whatever this finished floor is, since that's where our criteria is.
Okay, what's the elevation from the stage to the top of the standing room only behind the railing before the glass partitions? How many feet?
Let me see.
That can't be right, can it? Just because you have nine. Well, maybe it is. I think you have nine rows of seats, so each row of seats a foot.
That's not nine risers at 1 foot, that's 9 feet.
Okay. You said all three sides, east, west, south, are going to open. On one of the drawings, again, I can't tell because it's the first floor drawing. In the new storefront system, in the middle, it includes a new restaurant. Will that be connected to the new restaurant on the second floor?
No. I mean, it's potentially, it could be, but it's not intended to at this point.
Okay, and
that's a standalone. This is a standalone, and the one on the roof is a standalone.
And all their HVAC and everything will go up there with no problem? I'm sure the answer
all these all each have individual systems, relatively small systems. This has a bigger system. That will all be in here and, if necessary, over here. The mechanicals for this system, we contemplate a little closet for air handlers in here, ducts and feed down here, blow this way, ducts and feed down here, blow this way. And this area is contemplated for this tenant's kitchen down here since it has no outdoor exposure and no windows.
And again, I can't tell you what drawing to go to, so you'll find it. It's the one that shows, I guess it's the street front drawing. It says the point of beginning. Point of beginning, and it indicates it'd be the south side of the ramp that's in there now. So is that being reconstructed? Is that being lessened?
The McClellan's ramp?
The what?
Do you mean the McClellan's ramp?
No, no. South end of the building.
That's
the existing
Curly's drawing down
yes.
below.
Yes.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Curly's.
Yeah, it's probably this one. Yeah.
Curly's.
Okay, I apologize.
Sorry.
Okay. It says point of beginning. What does point of beginning mean? You're shutting that down while you're building?
No, that's just where the sidewalk ends and the ramp starts.
Well, we won't know that, but it's indicated on your maps that you're doing something to it.
I don't know. Well, we didn't prepare these,
let's
be honest. I don't know what that means.
Okay.
I'll find out.
That's the corner of the lot. If I could just interrupt here, with regard to the restaurants, it's designed that it could be separate or as one operator, so that we can.
That's totally yours. I was just curious if they were going to be connected, if where all the mechanicals on the top of it. Present mechanicals now, do a lot of those have to be relocated? Because I mean, they used to have the big mechanical.
We've got the big
from the
chiller up top, and that is.
And you had the big exhaust for the hot for this.
For the blue.
No,
so
the other the pottery place.
I can answer. Right now, you have very large chillers sitting right here. That's going to disappear.
Okay.
It's going to be replaced by more smaller units to serve the tenants individually. Right now, that's a single unit that serves the whole thing. At the same time, you have, McClellan's has, and they don't show on here, but right in this area, they have a series of units that sit on this roof and in a way. They'll have to go up on top of this roof and be relocated here. So they'll take up some of our space in here. And the rest of McClellan's mechanicals are all right in through here. And we do show some screen walls in here to hide McClellan's mechanicals from the street in this work.
And the only last thing, it said planters on the boardwalk, and I don't know. And that doesn't bother me one bit, I don't know. It's something new.
Okay.
And it I like it because it says where the boundary is, but that says make sure it's legal.
Now, right down, I can answer. He's showing where these existing planters are outside of the plants. That's proposed.
Okay.
Most of this is a survey was already there. There's
okay.
A little bit's changed in this plan.
Thank you. That's all I have.
I have a question. Carrie, what do you project will be the uses for this bench show? What will it be used as?
Right now, it's flexible. I mean, until we know who's going to take the tenant space, I mean, we're maintaining flexibility. I think most of the public who's here is here a lot will remember that, you know, this is now a private space. I know it used to be a public space, but it's now a private space. While we do assume that we'll be, you know, there from time to time will be public uses there, it is going to be something that we can also privately program for stuff. And so we're going to maintain flexibility. Events, ideally we would have someone as a tenant that can also program it for us and program it to its fullest extent. But without that tenant, I don't know. So we're maintaining maximum flexibility for music, theater, weddings, parties.
So this is pretty much an extension of the restaurant rather than a standalone venue.
Ideally, but it can also be, we can write it into an agreement that there has to be a certain number, you know, that we can, that we get to, you know, suggest, or that they'll do a number of events that we suggest, that sort of thing. So again, maximum flexibility. Again, it would be lovely if we could put the municipal band back up there instead of having them going on the boardwalk. It would be great if we could, you know, do that kind of thing. Can I tell you exactly when? I mean, that's all part of the sort of negotiation that we'd be getting to. But again, flexible entertainment space, you know, another open air flexible space.
So if there were a band, say there were an event there, maybe a fundraiser, the restaurant would have access to that area as well,
yes.
Correct? Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
That area would be accessible without traveling through any of the restaurants.
Right.
But it would be an extension of that restaurant. Anselm couldn't go host a fundraiser there because the restaurant folks would have access to it as well, correct?
We could, but then, I mean, you know, in our minds, again, with maximum flexibility, we're not going to put somebody up there that's going to say, you can never, ever, you know, do anything mm-hmm. you want. But then ideally, you're putting someone up there that's a good partner that allows us to have, you know, types of things when we want to. So it's kind of to be determined, but.
Okay, just trying to get an idea
sure.
of what was in your mind.
So we could maybe put language into the agreement, something like Convention Hall and Paramount, where the city gets so many free,
dates.
Even though they're not free.
No,
dates.
You already had to buy that app. Well, that was why I read you what's in the SDA.
I got to try.
I know, you can try. And I look, I mean, we're happy to talk about it. We're absolutely happy to talk about it. I just don't want to tie my hand behind that with, you know, being able to rent the space by saying today
mm-hmm.
what's going on. I mean, it's now a private space.
Okay.
Questions?
Nope.
Amen?
No. Okay, mm-hmm. And so for next meeting, capacity of bathrooms, is you'd like that information sent to you?
Yeah, but you don't have to come and make a presentation.
No, I just need something that I can email to Michael.
Yeah, just tell us what the capacity would be for inside, outside,
okay.
And I know when you go to build, the construction
yes.
is going to make sure you have the capacity.
They are.
I'm just curious about the capacity of both inside and outside.
We'll get that information to you. Thank you.
Okay.
Wow. Great, we'll now move on to our next presentation, which is by Rob McEwen, Director of Property Maintenance, and Michelle Alonzo, Director of Planning, regarding summer rental ordinance.
So, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, my understanding was that, I guess, at the last meeting, you had been considering some amendments to the current summer rental licensing ordinance that was adopted back in 2014. And I guess the way that came about was because, as part of the zoning compliance piece, when people went to get their summer rental COs, they had to go to Barbara Van Wagner as a zoning officer. And she would then complete the zoning compliance. And I guess there was some interpretation issues with the current ordinance, the way it's written. And so we proposed some changes to that language. And my understanding was you wanted me to appear to answer some questions that the council might have.
Maybe you could, Rob, just explain what the ordinance says and then the changes that you want to make to it.
Sure. So. The current ordinance requires that if someone wants to rent their property for the period from Memorial Day through Labor Day, that would be categorized as a summer rental. It says the definition of the summer rental currently under the ordinance is that it means residential properties rented by owners or agents acting on behalf of owners for temporary occupancy by tenants for all or any portion of the period between Memorial Day and Labor Day. This section shall not apply to rooming houses or boarding houses which are licensed and or regulated separately. Additionally, the section shall not apply to apartment units which are specifically excluded from the definition of summer rental. So the question became, I guess Barbara's understanding was that the intention of the council when they first adopted this, and I thought maybe that was the same thing, and you'll have to answer that, was that the summer ordinance or summer rental ordinance was only applying to single family residences and not necessarily anything more than that. There's no definition in the current ordinance as to what constitutes an apartment unit that's excluded. It also doesn't talk about whether two family properties are permitted as a summer rental or whether multiple dwellings, which would be anything three units or more, would be constitutes a multiple dwelling. So we needed some clarification to the ordinance. We proposed some language to the council, and I'll read the new language as we proposed, and that talks about the definition of summer rental, meaning residential properties which, number one, constitute the primary residence of the owner thereof, and number two, contain no more than two individual dwelling units, and three, are rented by the owners or agents acting on behalf of the owners for temporary occupancy by tenants for all or any portion of the period between Memorial Day and Labor Day. This section shall not apply to rooming houses or boarding houses which are licensed and or regulated separately. And additionally, this section shall not apply to apartment units located within multifamily dwellings consisting of three or more dwelling units. So it defined what apartment units were and how they were excluded, which are specifically excluded from the definition of the summer rentals. So that's the proposed new language for the ordinance. And my understanding was that you wanted us to appear to talk about some questions you might have. I thought maybe Michelle could talk a little bit about the zoning and planning aspect of these short-term rentals, because I think that's important that you understand what we're doing here, because this is going to translate into, I think we have to have a larger conversation down the road as to what the city does going into the rest of the year with regard to short-term rentals. Currently, we had a virtual meeting with a company that mapped out our current listings. They did research on all of the online sites for all listings in the city of Asbury Park, and they identified, as of today, 145 listings on online sites such as Airbnb, VRBO, and sites like that. So that there's 145 listings for properties in the city currently of people renting their properties or trying to rent their properties as short-term rentals. I had a report last week that there was someone in the city that rented their property for the week of July 4th for $10,000. So I think this is going to be a bigger issue we have to talk about going forward. But I think right now, obviously, we're just here to talk about what's left for the season, because we have to know what to do. We've only got, and I should mention that there's only 13 property owners that came in and applied for summer COs out of the entire city.
So that means 120 are not.
Well, it doesn't mean that they're rent. Those are people that have listed their properties to rent.
As a short-term rental.
As a short-term rental on those online sites.
So unless they're coming in consistently for a long-term, for a regular CO.
And they're not.
Of course they're not. So that's a large number of people that are not getting.
They're just not doing anything. They're not
right.
Doing, they're not complying with it.
And that means police, fire, no one knows who's in those units.
Mm-hmm. And if I could just step in for a moment and clarify something before Michelle reports out on the zoning aspects of this. Back in 2014, when the original summer rental ordinance was adopted, the intention was to encourage Asbury Park to be more of a destination and a resort type community, and to encourage people who, for instance, might be going away for the summer to be able to rent their home out while they were away. And essentially, with the summer rental ordinance, you get a benefit in that under ordinary circumstances, if you're going to rent your property out to tenants, our code requires, as most municipalities do, that you get a new certificate of occupancy, that you have the inspections that are done by code enforcement and other departments in the city, and the price is $100, and you have to get a new CFO every time there's a transfer in occupancy. And the summer rental ordinance was to make it easier if a landlord was going to have multiple tenants during the course of that time period, that specified time period between Memorial Day and Labor Day, so that no matter how many different occupancies they had during that period of time between Memorial Day and Labor Day, they wouldn't have to, every time there was a change in occupancy, come back to the city and pay $100 and get a new CFO and have new inspections done. They would simply apply for and receive a summer rental CFO, which would require them to pay one fee of $250 and have one inspection. And then they would get this rental CFO that would be good for the entire summer, no matter how many times they rented it out, whether it was for 10 weeks or however many different occupancies they had. They wouldn't have to come back every single time and pay and get a new CFO and have new inspections. So if your property doesn't qualify as a summer rental under the terms of this ordinance, you still can rent it out as many times as you want to during the course of the summer. You just don't get the benefit of that pay one price and one CFO inspection. So I just wanted to make sure that you were clear that because there are only certain types of properties that would be considered eligible for a summer rental under this ordinance, if you have a property that doesn't qualify, you still can summer rent your property. You just have to go through the regular process specified in our code. So I'll turn it over at this point to Michelle.
And my understanding, and someone could correct me if I'm wrong, is this ordinance was originally adopted to have some sort of control over summer rentals. And I guess there was the foresight that this was the beginning of the tide that we've started to see this season, where there are, you know, in our office, the Planning, Redevelopment, Zoning Office, we're seeing an uptick of people coming in buying properties exclusively for summer rental, that or looking to do so. You know, they do not live here, they don't intend to live here at all, or at least in the short term, they intend to rent it out, because with the publicity that we've been getting, which is great publicity, the eyes on Asbury Park, especially for investors. And investors in a Hampton type market, where you buy a large house and you rent it to large groups of people, you know, with two to a bedroom. And the planning implication for that, of course, it's multi-layered. One, of course, is the parking. Homes that are intended to be one family now can have up to 10 different individuals, or depending on the size of the house, you know, coming with their own cars. There's the quality of life issue that some people, you know, on what is actually occurring at the house on those weekends. And the idea that the home ownership portion of it is that if it's your primary residence, that you might have more care in who you rent to. That's the theory behind it. This is not something that we invented. Other municipalities have it anywhere close to them, such as Belmar, who has a reputation, or had, at least when I was younger, a reputation of being a party place. And although they've been working, they very much have worked to dispel that image through various ordinances, but places like San Francisco have it as well. It's a measure to try to have some controls over the short-term market. And we're beginning to see an uptick in the purchase of homes that are not primary residents, nor is someone's secondary residence, but investment properties for renting out exclusively for summer rental.
What you should mention too is that we talked about the primary residence piece, and I think that the reason behind that, and there's been many communities around the country, I didn't find too many in New Jersey, but there's many communities in the country that have adopted that piece in their short-term rental ordinance. Some have seasonal, some have year-round short-term rental ordinances. And the reason is that they say essentially that by not including it as their primary residence, it becomes a business. The property becomes a business. And so you're dropping these businesses all around residential neighborhoods. You're having many hotels in residential neighborhoods without any regard for the zoning and planning aspects.
So we've just, I have a couple of concerns about it, similar to the ones that I have before. I mean, the requiring it to be your primary residency, and I use this example multiple times. I lived in the Santander for 15 years. I still own a unit there. I have absolutely no intention of doing short-term rentals, so this should never apply to me, or I certainly don't have any intentions of doing it anytime soon. So what puzzles me is that I live on Third Ave, and if I wanted to do a short-term rental, I couldn't, unless I couldn't do the summer short-term rental. If I lived in the unit in the Santander, and I rented it out, and I went to DC with my wife to spend time with her family the entire summer, where I'm MIA, I can do that. But if I live on Third Ave and I want to rent out my secondary property in the Santander, I can't. And so the logic behind that makes me a little sticky. Why wouldn't you want me here to be capable of taking care of any problem? And I understand that you have to give a name or a number of somebody who's going to help. And then the other part of the residency requirement is I guess I'm concerned that, is there any sort of, could it be interpreted as discriminatory in nature, right? We're only allowing people who use it as their primary residence to rent it out. And so all I'm asking is that we just double check that. Double check that aspect of it. And then, I think I understand what Rob's trying to get a hold on. And Michelle, I think I understand what you guys are trying to get a hold on. I don't know that this does it. I mean, we can certainly entertain it, but this is a much bigger conversation, and I love the suggestion that somebody mentioned at the meeting about having the animal house ordinance, which means two or three noise complaints, and the city's coming after you for thousands of dollars for that, or to bond with the city for thousands. So, like, if we're passing this to just better interpret what we worked on a couple of years ago, that's one thing, but the bigger discussion is the issues that happen, right? Do we have entire blocks of Airbnbs? Do we limit them to areas, which, Rob's obviously suggested in a conversation that I had with him today. Do we limit them to certain, three B&Bs in District 1, three B&Bs in District 2, so you get a hold and it's not a block? If this is for clarification purposes, I think I'm okay, but I think we have to get ahead of the problems that you both clearly already see.
Right, and that, yes, I completely agree. The reason this is here tonight is actually to allow a little bit more flexibility, that if you have a two-family and you're living in one unit, then you can do the summer rental. This has been in place since 2014, so this is just a slight tweaking to clarify it. But we completely agree in the administration that we need to be working on other types of legislation to control and regulate rentals. And it's something that Rob has been looking into.
And maybe we could just get some clarification, Fred, on the legality of requiring the residency requirement.
I have a question. What's happening with the other 132 people that have their places for rent? Do we monitor that?
That's the problem,
that list?
Is
do
that,
we?
Well, first of all, we don't have enough manpower right this second to be able to be out there enforcing it. But, once we do, the plan is, a lot of this happens on weekends. Mm-hmm. And last summer, what we did was we had a code enforcement officer working on the weekends, Saturday and Sunday. And so that's one of the duties that he would have, is to go around and scout around the city and try and identify if there are homes that are being rented, say, hey, are you ready? And wouldn't just go cold call on properties. We have some background information to be able to do that.
And then what's the follow-up after that?
Well, if they're renting it without having gotten a CO, they get a summons automatically, and then they come to court, and there's a fine.
Okay. But that's not happening this summer. You don't see that happening this summer with lack of manpower.
The ones we know, we found out about a property the other day that was It's a front house and a back house. It's broken up into 5 units in the front house, 2 units in the back house, and the person has been renting the property without having ever obtained CO, and for weekends or overnights or whatever, so there's constant traffic in and out. And, you know, again, there's neighbors that are calling us with problems and issues about, hey, I didn't buy my house and I'm not paying these high taxes to be living in a neighborhood where mm-hmm. I have a revolving door next door. That's not what I intended when I bought my invested here.
I think, Eileen, I hear your point as well, that this is bigger mm-hmm. than yep. just clarifying what we thought we were doing. I believe we did a good thing a few years ago and clarifying that, but if we don't get ahead of it and have a plan, a strong plan for next summer, then we have a major problem.
But Amy, I think that we need to understand that this isn't just summer. This is going
yeah.
to be
right.
all year round. You got to deal with the short-term rental issue
right.
all year round.
Although, arguably, it's the worst in the summer. I mean, people aren't, I love Asbury Park, but people aren't flocking here in February.
More and more people are coming other time in the fall, in the spring.
But
It's you know, the holidays.
My concern is, in addition to, if people are buying homes for investment purposes that they're gonna rent because they're making great sums of money in the summer and they'll leave it vacant all year round, what about our rental market? Is it going to suffer because now those houses are no longer available? And we're already starting to have issues with affordable housing, and where are people going to live? Because these houses are being used only for short-term rentals, and they're sitting there vacant the rest of the year because it doesn't matter. I'm making enough money to pay the expenses year-round.
Exactly. And that's one of the arguments that a lot of these communities around the country that are regulating short-term rentals are making, is that it's influencing and causing a problem with their long-term rental markets and their affordable housing markets. So it's cutting down. People find out they can make, hey, I can make $10,000 for a week. Pays my mortgage for a few months. I don't
sure.
have to deal with a rental for the whole year. And then the properties sit there vacant. And it also drives the prices up for the rentals for the rest of the properties, for year-round rentals.
So as Amy said, this is much bigger than just the summer rental. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we'll move on to review of agenda items for Wednesday night's meeting.
I asked all my questions and I'm happy.
Yeah, I mean, I can just do a couple of quick ones, Michael. Just the second reading of the ordinance for the road repair stuff for 4th Ave, is that on hold now because of the Christie putting everything on hold?
You can table it if you desire, but
would it be better to pass it and then
it would just be better to pass it to have it. 4th Avenue is on the list, but we don't anticipate even starting design until the fall, so it's better just to knock it out right now and just get it out of the way just in case.
Just because there was something on the news tonight where Sweeney's making a proposal to the governor tomorrow as far as the gasoline tax, so all this could go away
tomorrow.
I have no problem passing it. I wasn't sure if it was affected by it, and then
it's affected by it.
Okay. The green building practices, this is a standard that we're trying to encourage other business, the resolution, the 2016-307, encouraging other, if Michelle's still here, she can probably answer, encouraging other people to use green standards, right?
Yes, resolutions 306 and 307 are part of the Sustainable New Jersey requirement. It is pushing the private sector and the public sector to use best practices, whether in greening and open space. It doesn't make a policy, but it's a recommendation as part of Sustainable New Jersey. We're gonna have a bunch more of the Sustainable New Jersey resolutions and possible ordinances over the next six months or so as we move forward getting certification.
That's it. That's all
Thank
I got.
You.
Move on to.
I mean, it's very little.
We'll move on to matters by city council. Anybody got matters?
Nothing.
No? Nobody got nothing?
I mean, the only thing I'll say is I've been at the beach every weekend thus far this summer. And the lines continue in terms of buying beach badges and stuff like that. I just would, you know, I'd love it if we could just be a little more cognizant on whether or not we need more beach staff down there or innovative ways for people to get badges. But on the Fifth Ave Beach, there is a line to get a beach badge. And at the trailer, there's a line to get a beach badge every Saturday and Sunday. Which is a wonderful thing. I'm just wondering, can we figure out ways to get people beach badges? I know we do it, yeah, I know we do it in the meters. And I know we were doing an app for it. I don't know where the status of that is.
It's up and running. I don't know the usage stats yet. I was waiting like 4 to 6 weeks to get it up to see what it looks like.
Okay.
Do people know about this app?
We've advertised it. So yes, we will send out another release. It's gonna take a year for it. Saturation, and even the guy whose app it is said it's going to take a little bit of time to get.
Can we put signs though near where they're already purchasing
badges, where they're
online, so they know that there's another option for them?
And maybe on the meters.
Or even near, yeah, even near the meters.
Saying you don't have to wait online to buy your badge.
Something tells me there may be signs at the meters already.
That you can.
Just because, I'm going to be wrong on the numbers, but it's going from like say 200 a month to 5,000 a month.
To buy your badge at the meter.
Yeah, it's okay. Going up tremendously from
that. Then Eileen's point's perfect. Put it near, get signs up by where people are actually selling the tickets. In particular, the worst line is the trailer. And those people might be buying season badges, so this might be moot, but the worst lines on the boardwalk in the summer are at the trailer at this point.
Should we put it on the digital sign that we own?
Sure.
I think that would be great.
Yeah.
Go ahead, but how many people are riding up and down Main Street going to the beach?
Well, you pass Sunset Park, in theory. If you came from Sunset, okay. You would ride.
Nothing hurts. So put.
And then we put it in a couple of the next blasts.
Keep on blasting it out, yeah. But yeah, I'll give you the numbers. It's unbelievable how much is being taken into the meters now.
Well, I mean, that much is being taken in, and there's still lines.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Any other matters? No. All right, matters from the city manager. We have one item listed for discussion, municipal court debt collection.
Over the last few years, the city has utilized a third party for court debt. Currently, there's approximately $1.5 million in outstanding money that the court is owed. The company that we currently use has been on a month-to-month since last summer, give or take, and they just approached us if the contract should be extended. My opinion is no, and we should go back out for someone else. The judge and court administrator agree that we should try something else. The company sent me an email that they've collected $40,000 out of this $1.5 million. So that's pretty abysmal. And so in the next week or two, hope to get another RFP out, but we do need notification to them that we're going to cancel the contract, which we'll do by resolution in the next at the next meeting, and then go out to bid, give them notification that we're going somewhere.
I didn't know if Kevin was here.
Kevin's not here.
Just to give you a little bit of background, and Fred can fill you in because this drove Fred crazy. I mean, we went after this gung-ho, and we were told to go after this gung-ho by the state's MOU, and we had to get this one to sign off, this one to sign off. I mean, it was a year and a half process just to get a company to be able to bid on it. And I think the state realized it was a waste of time, because when we met with them, we said a year and a half ago, as far as the MOU, they said, what do you think about the court process? Because we're thinking about other towns. We said, scrap it, because it's not working.
the way you made us do it. So, you know, we, if we took in $40,000, obviously we took in more than we spent. But, I mean, it drove Fred crazy because it had to go to every
administrative office of the courts has to approve it, and it was a cumbersome process.
Well, so because we've already been approved once, we won't have to go through that process again.
Maybe if we change a little bit with AOC, we'll have to verify with them.
We can contact the AOC and let them know that we're potentially going through the same process, and hopefully it would be more streamlined this time around if you are going to go back out to RFP.
The DCA is not going to be an issue from, you know, the fiscal monitor side.
They weren't the issue the last time. It was just
it's the AOC slow. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, that's where we stand with that.
Any other matters?
The Sunset Avenue footbridge opening is tomorrow. So if that is acceptable, it will be not on for Wednesday, but the following week. And then the week after that, on Wednesday, for the 27th meeting, we should, we'll know the bid results for the road program. But right now, Sunset Avenue, which we have about $600,000 tied up into it with state money, is frozen. So we're thinking, depending on what happens in the next couple of days, it could be weeks, with the Transportation Trust Fund, we have 60 days to award. So it will put a kink in the scheduling depending on how fast the state acts. But right now, unless something happens by the 27th, we're going to recommend just hold for 60 days and wait until something gets done. We can ask for extensions, or we'll just reject and have to rebid. And if we rebid, well, then we're going to recommend going out in the winter and include 4th Avenue also. So it's a larger project with probably will be a better rate scale. Currently, 15 bid holders have picked up the specs, so that is a very good number. So we'll get competitive pricing, it looks like. It's just going to be up to the state with the Transportation Trust Fund. That's all I have.
Yeah, but some of the other streets, like Park and Steiner, they're not contingent upon the state money.
God, I hope Steiner isn't, because it's like, oh my God, Steiner is terrible.
Knowing yes, because the way the bond was written, it's that was used as part of it. And we did receive word today that Transit's not going to let us do part of Steiner. That is their property of it, and we're looking for the map to send out to everyone.
Which part of Steiner's there?
I think I'll get the map, and it's just easier to describe.
Well, then send them a violation notice tomorrow, tell them that they're in default for not maintaining it.
Yeah,
it's a mess. So I know Christine was going to try to talk to him today when I spoke to her this morning. So yes, we're working on those two things. It's, I'll have to talk to bond counsel to see what we can do or pull out for the road program. But I don't believe we're going to be able to pull out much. And I'll see bond counsel on Wednesday.
Okay.
Matters by city attorney?
I have no matters at this time.
All right. Can I have a motion to open the meeting up to the public then?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
All opposed? The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order after appropriate warning and may terminate any comments from the speaker. Each speaker has 3 minutes to speak. And please state your name and address for the record, please.
Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. I wasn't going to talk about summer rentals, but sitting on the beach last week, there was three couples. They rented a house on 6th and Emory. That house was just sold, and all of a sudden, it's a summer rental with three families in it. I think you should cancel this whole thing. It's a bigger problem than you think it is. You have three families living in one house now, just for the summer. And the other thing is, I have friends that live next door to pools. Thank God I don't live next door to one. These people that are on vacation, it's fine. They're having a good time. But there's people that live there all year round. They don't want to hear anybody swimming 4 o'clock in the morning. I mean, there's a lot of things to consider here. This is it's also a residential town. If you want to do something like that, maybe you should do it towards the beach the way it used to be. They had bed and breakfasts years ago, but they were all by the beach. They were like a block away from the beach. They weren't in the whole neighborhood, in the whole town. There's signs all over the place telling you that there's summer rentals. There's another house on Sunset that just rents to parties. I'm sure he doesn't get a CO. So I think you really should carefully look at this. This is not a good thing for Asbury. Belmar got rid of it, and it's not good for us.
Well, just so you know, Rita, we took Belmar's summer CO, what they have now, and we use that as an example. So Belmar absolutely has summer COs, but they regulate them.
Yeah, but we're not smart enough to regulate it. I got news for you. If you think you're smart enough, there's many other things that are going on here, and nobody is paying attention to them. More important things. I mean, those summer rentals, what are they going to bring us? I have one next door to me, too. And there's a different family every weekend with a suitcase. I mean, like, come on. You have too many other problems. You have problems on the beachfront. My granddaughter I bought her a license so she could go up to the boardwalk, and she does hula hooping. The policeman sees her, and he tells her, you can't stand here. This is the 4th of July weekend. You're not allowed. And he made her leave. I mean, like, there's things like that, little things. I wasn't upset, but she didn't call me. If she would have called me, I would have been on the phone. But she didn't call me. I mean, things like that. Nobody knows what they're doing around here. You go up to the beachfront to buy a beach pass, and they're selling season tickets at the same time. And the line is long. I mean, nobody seems to know their job, for one thing. And summer rentals, you're going to have a lot of problems with them. The other thing is, I hope everybody got their tax bill this week, and I hope they're happy with them. Oh, I didn't finish.
Go ahead, because we took a couple minutes.
No, I was just going to say, because the newspaper and the governor said that we're spending 64% more than we're supposed to, according to the state guidelines, we got to do something about it.
Okay, 15 seconds.
Thank you, John.
So
thank you.
You switch subjects.
Thank you, John. I appreciate it.
I think you're misinterpreting. We agree with you on summer rentals, and we're looking to get that under control. So we're in agreement with you. So, and like Amy said, it's a bigger problem than we think it is now. So no, we're in agreement with that. As far as your granddaughter on the boardwalk, if she was like between Convention Hall and First Avenue, she probably was thrown off because we have to close it down because that's where the fireworks go. So everybody was thrown off. So it probably just wasn't her. I know she wasn't thrown off down by 8th Avenue, so that's something you can look into. As far as what the governor said, as far as 64% and everything, I forget the saying, numbers lie and liars number. I mean, you can take that number. What he was trying to say is, like, Asbury Park is an anomaly that we pay more in city taxes than in school taxes because of the amount of aid given to the school system, which in a normal town and regular towns, the school tax is the majority of your tax bill, much more than the city tax. Here, it is not because of the amount of state aid the Board of Ed is getting, which I'm thankful they're getting. But I mean, it's very easy for me, anybody, the governor, to throw numbers around and people to take them out of context. And I don't think you're taking them out of context. I think he said that statement out of context.
I don't know. But I don't know if you heard this week, they're going to freeze the transitional aid.
They're going to what?
The transitional aid might be frozen.
It was frozen, it was executive order 2009, I'm going to say a week and a half ago. 2010 was the freezing the money for, the governor made two executive orders. I wish I could make an executive order. I could cure the problems for them. I could cure, but I don't have the power. So the governor made executive order 209, which says right now, any city, I think there's 21 of us, or I forget, 13, in the state of New Jersey, that we're told to put in your budget, which we did, and we put in $1.2 million in our budget because we were told by the state of New Jersey, that's what you should calculate in your budget that the state's going to give us, because he got all his city over him not getting his gasoline tax, he froze it. He froze it by an executive order. Same as the next day, executive order 2010, he froze
no more, don't fix the streets, let them just cave over again because he did not get his gas leak tax. We've met with our state monitor. We got the hard facts. We put in for $1.2 million. We weren't sure if we were going to get that, but we knew we were hoping we'd get close to that. And right now, we're preparing a budget in case we get zero. And memos went out to every department head as soon as we heard of this, like put a spending freeze on. So we're doing our due diligence as far as, like, we don't know what Trenton's doing. And we're not a normal city. We cannot adopt a budget. And we ask our state monitor, who's from the Division of Local Government Services, when can we adopt a budget? We don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Well, the governor's office isn't telling us anything. So when they tell us, we'll tell you. Until then, Asbury Park, Camden, Newark, Trenton, whatever, you're being held hostage by the governor. And that's factual. Jerry?
Hello, Mayor and Council. Jerry Scarano, Long Branch. I was at the fireworks. I know a really good 4th of July. But as I was walking through the arcade at Convention Hall, I noticed the copper ship was missing on the north side. I don't remember the last time I saw it. It may be in storage, but somebody we know has a bad track record for storing copper, so maybe that boat should be put back up there, restored, and when are we getting the copper panels back? Now, the new Pryor, or the Arthur Pryor Pavilion, the restaurant looked like a great idea. I would like you guys to consider asking, instead of rubber stamping the project, that the roof be used for something useful like solar panels or something for that, a better environmental product for the city or whatever. That's not really what I meant, but they should do something that makes it useful instead of being passive, because when you're in the Asbury, you're going to see a big blank spot before you can see activity with the bandstand that they're not there anymore. So just to have a flat roof and then the beach and the ocean, something creative should be done with the roof. I think at least panels would work. And then on the side of the building where they raised, did away with the bandstand, that both sides of the building should be able to tell tourists what the new events are for that weekend or what's going to happen. Should be a light like you would have on Broadway, and also high and low tide and the temperature and the time, so people will always look at the restaurant since that'll be a new landmark, but it'll help the public when you're in the park, when you're driving around, you'll see a sign, you know, 50, 60 foot long telling you things that are going on. But I like the idea of high and low tide and the temperature of the water, the air, something useful instead of just decorative bricks. Since we lost the panels, maybe they could give something back to us in the meantime to show goodwill. And I hope you ask for that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jan Sparrow, 2nd Avenue. I just want to respond to something Ms. Moreno said. Honestly, I think people in this city do know what they're doing. I've been in City Hall more than once lately and have had great response from Cindy's office. I had to pay a parking ticket because I totally screwed up. There was a line. They opened different doors. They've worked really hard around here, I think, over the last year or so to make sure nothing will ever be perfect. I totally understand we have issues everywhere in this country, and yet I think it's important that we, instead of make broad statements that nobody knows what they're doing around here, it's so not true. As I listened to John explain what the city is doing, because Christie, being the wonderful governor that he is doing what he's doing to our city, and yet our community leaders have already decided how to deal with that. So I really feel like they know what they're doing, or at least everyone up there knows what they're doing. People downtown know what they're doing. Michelle has been incredibly responsive every time we've talked to her about some event or something that we like to be done in the city. I work with the DPW on cleaning up the streets. There's a guy down there, Ken. I go to visit him once a week with all my crap, and he's been telling me all the good stuff he's trying to do to help our city be more beautiful. beautiful. So honestly, rather than talk about nobody knows what they're doing around here, I think we need to either be more specific or really think about how hard people in this town work all the time to make sure it's a really great place, and spend more time thinking about what's working instead of always thinking about what's not working. Okay, now I'm done.
Have a motion to close the public portion?
Move it.
Second.
All right.
Motion to adjourn?
No,
go ahead.
I'll give you 30 seconds.
I forgot to say it because Rita, you asked a question, I forget the questions. Yes, we all did get a tax bill. I'm going to tell you something. There was a little piece of paper in there, and it was FAQ, frequently asked questions. And that was designed because last year, we sent out the third quarter tax bills and we did a bad job. And we got so many phone calls, and that was designed by our tax assessor, Eric Aguilar, with help with the tax collector. And I think it helped people a lot. So if you read those frequently asked questions, you'll find out about what's going on with your taxes. And I gotta say, that again is being reactive because last year we didn't do it, but proactive, trying to help the public understand, because third quarter being a city on transitional aid is tough to explain to people.
And the other thing in your tax bill was a pamphlet that our communications director, which talked about some of the things that we've accomplished in the last year or two, and some of the things that we've gotten done. So a reminder for people who are not online, when you got your tax bill, we at least tried to outline some of the great stuff that's happened, one of which is getting Springwood Ave Park off the ground.
Second. All in favor? All opposed? All right, meeting is adjourned.